Nancy. Close enough. You ready, Nancy?
Sure.
And I'm not even going to introduce you because I've known you for a long time, but I still can't pronounce your name.
Nancy B.
Well, I always called you Nancy B.
Nice shortcut.
Been Schooenderwoert. Okay. In here someplace about my background, so I'll go over that. This talk is entitled Agile from the Engine Room, Making the World Safe for Geeks. When I'm describing what I do about Agile coaching, you know, just informally talking with people, especially technical people, you know, they'll often ask me, what's this really about? and I would say a phrase something like that. I would say, well, you know, in my own mind, I think of it as just making the world safe for good geeks, because what frustrated me so much in most of the projects I worked on is this phenomenon where everybody who has control over the decision making starts getting swept away by the illusion of control that they want to have, you know, and the sunny side estimates that they want to demand from everybody, and there doesn't seem to be any room for the voice from the people who know what is really involved. You know, there doesn't seem to be any room for that to come through. So the thing that I like about Agile methods, when it's done right, is that it does provide that space. So let me say a little bit about my background before I launch into that. I've spent around 15 years working in safety critical, mostly embedded systems, large systems and small, starting with flight simulators, and that's where I got into flying and small planes. But you know, in flight simulation, you really get a systems view of things. A lot of things, training as well. And I also work in sonar weaponry, it says here, scientific instrument work, and also financial services, but that is in coaching. My background's electrical engineering and software engineering both. And I guess that's all I'm gonna say about that for the moment, because I really wanna get into the substance of what we're gonna do today. My talk is in four parts, and they're not of equal size. About 85% of the talk is going to be this virtual tour of a real Agile team, because I'd rather show you than just tell you. I'd like to show you what daily life is like for a team that I coached not too long back. And a lot of times it's you can't get clients to say, okay, they need to use photographs, you know, from their team room or details of what they're doing. But these people said all right to that, so I'm happy to show that to you. So this is the bulk of the talk. I do want to hit on a little bit of what this has in common with open source. You know, it's Boston Linux Unix after all. And I also want to finish up with a so what? You know, what should this mean for you? And I know full well that at least a little birdie tells me that there are people here, probably here, who maybe had bad experiences under the banner of Agile. And there's a lot of companies around doing something that they call Agile that I probably wouldn't recognize as such. Does anybody want to self-identify as having a bad experience under such situations? One in the back? Any others? Okay. Well, I hear about this from folks, and I think the story needs to come out, the good and the bad. Okay. So, we'll say a little bit here about Agile and open source and some of the myths. Okay, what are the similarities? And I'm not the first one to note this. There's been a fair amount written about it. The whole notion of working for change, working for something you care about, and profits coming secondary. Not that people don't earn money doing open source work, but it's not really the fundamental point. Leadership being earned, you know, the meritocracy thing, I like that. I like the idea that it's about the doers, you know, and that sooner or later, if you're all talk and no substance, that kind of gets found out in the open source community as it does in the Agile community. Rewards tend to be about reputation and connections and opportunities. And control is generally intrinsic rather than, you know, carrot and stick kind of controls. The differences, as I see it, is mostly about Agile being done in the paid work setting, you know, in office setting. Ideally, with co-located teams, but a lot of times people are separated and various means are used to try to bridge that, often not very satisfactorily, but we'll say a little something about that later on, too. The interesting thing for me about open source is that people coordinate across huge communities, not just the community of contributors. I was reading some about the Eclipse philosophy and how they define it as part of their success that they have lots of adopters, not just the contributors, okay? And, you know, that there are companies that are willing to create plugins and so forth for that platform. So there's big overlapping communities, and they find a way to work it out and through some kind of experiments in bureaucracy, which I think is really interesting. A little bit about myths. All of these here are things that I've heard. I've heard people say Scrum implements in a day. Now, the fellow who said that is one of the founders of Scrum, but what he means is you can make up your mind right this instant and begin practicing it. But people take it to mean that in one day you can learn all you need to know to perform it correctly, and that's not true. I've heard people say the plannings will just emerge, you don't have any upfront planning. Well, there might be some cases where you could actually do that, but I think they're few and far between, and I have not encountered any of the work that I do. Just work faster. A friend of mine was doing some contract work here in the Boston area, and she said to me, Nancy, these people say they're doing Agile, but it doesn't sound like anything you talk about. And I said, well, what are they doing? And she says, well, everybody's in one big room, and you just have to work really fast, and you never can take a break, and you have really long hours. And I said, well, are they talking to each other because they're together? She says, no, nobody talks to each other. Nobody helps each other. And I said, well, she says, they even IM across the table. So I said, that doesn't sound like anything I understand as Agile. She says, yeah, they say they're an Agile team. I said, no, this is one of these bad things. And another person who I know in the local area here, he's a manager at a company, and he said that in the company where he works, and he has a lot of conversations with the executives, you know, in his role as a senior manager. He says that the top guy there, he takes it as an absolute commitment when their Agile team says that they'll deliver some amount of features right in the coming iteration. That's an absolute commitment. And if it's not ready on the due date, what happens, I asked him. He says, the team just has to keep on slogging until it's ready. I said, what, you work all night or something? He says, yeah, that's what the guy says. It's an absolute commitment. And I asked him, well, is there any such commitment on the flip side? I mean, what if there's issues that the team can't, that they don't have the authority to change? You know, problems that come up. I said, do the managers hustle as hard to make sure those things are dealt with? He says, oh, no. There's no such commitment in the other direction.
That's not the job of a manager.
You're right. No such commitment the other way. And I said, aha, okay. Because he knows that sometimes I talk about this phenomenon that I call the Agile sweatshop. And it doesn't belong there. So this is how it's being practiced in his company. And I said, that's really bad. I wouldn't want to work in that environment. And so there's quite a few myths out there. And what I would like to do is, coming up next, is I'd like to show you what things are like for the real team. And let me set this up a little bit. I'm going to show you some photographs of the team room. And before I get into it, though, let me tell you how that came about. I was coaching this team. They're an American team working for a German company. And some of the people they need to work with are there in Germany. And those people in Germany built a framework, okay, software framework, that these American team is extending for a new product in the line of products. And it's process monitoring equipment. It's safety critical equipment. In fact, it's the kind of things that you'd use in chemical plants or refineries and so on to monitor things like flows and pressures and so forth. So they have to do this just a pretty stringent safety. licenses and so forth. So this team, and they also have some folks from Japan who they're working with. So they're all together going through their first iteration in the photos that you're going to see. And I've been mostly focusing on coaching the American team, although the ideas have spread and the managers in Germany are teaching it to their teams and looking for some more coaching on that. And David here, say hi, David. David here has been over to see them, so probably recognize some of the photos. David has met the German team, who started picking up these practices just slightly after the American team began using them. So we're going to see some pictures from a corner. We hijacked the manager's office while we were over there. He was the manager who was in favor of Agile. He gave up his corner office for the team to get rolling. And these will be pictures of the American team working together with some of the people from Japan. And the German team is nearby to advise, but they're not on the project, not on this team that we'll see. And I also want to say something. There's a fair amount of effort that goes before you start day one of your iteration. Okay? People know what their architecture was going to be, at least in high-level form. There were some unknowns that they needed to investigate, okay? But you can begin doing your iterations and dig out some of those answers as you go. There was certainly some effort you spent about a week, more like 2 weeks, was spent in understanding Agile requirements. We do this thing we call story writing, and you'll see some details about that. Try to break the requirements down into little microcosms in order to stay in better control. So we spent some time doing that before setting up the team room. So then what was going on is as the team, they did a two-week iteration. While they were doing this, I said to the project manager, now other people in nearby departments who are curious about what's going on, offer to give them a tour. You know, just take names, little batches, and I'll give them a tour each day. So I was doing that. So I would just kind of walk them through and show them these artifacts and explain them. And so I had pictures of each one, and that's what we're going to do. So I thought, gee, this would make a nice little canned presentation. So that's what this is. So as we walk into the team room, one of the things we see first is this whiteboard that may look a little bit messy. I'm going to stand out outside of this light in my face right now. This whiteboard might look a little bit messy, but I want to point out that what the team is doing here is they're taking each one of these things on a green sticky is some capability, some small functional bit of work that they want to do. And what's on the pink paper is the criterion that it's got to meet to be considered done. Think of it as your constraints. I'll show you some examples of these in just a minute. But so they start setting these out on the whiteboard, asking themselves the question, which of these things could we do immediately? And which of these things have to come after something else? So you can see maybe kind of a like a network diagram sideways almost, right? Showing up your dependencies. So they're trying to identify some handful of these things that could be started immediately, but don't depend on one another. And that's a good way to identify a starting point. And then as the dependency lines span out, that's where you kind of put your breaks in time for your iterations. That way, in each iteration, you're working on items that are independent from each other. So if one of them can't be completed, it doesn't force you to delete several others. So that's what they did with this whiteboard. And they're just this is just an arrangement of what some of their poem stories, what their stories look like. The reason we call them stories is we instead of people trying to specify a system with all sorts of rules, we want them to tell us a story about how they would like to use the system, how it should behave, from the user's point of view. Just give them a talk. So that's kind of where it comes from. Let's go a little further. So let's take a closer look at a story. Here's a typical story. Remember, this is an embedded systems team. It's their first iteration. So they're doing some stories that seem very technical, but they are still function-oriented. And by that, what I mean is something like this. This hot bus is a serial bus. They're looking to install this capability so that the system can read a single hart value at a fixed address over the serial bus. And so, okay, that captures a capability. And now you put some boundaries on it by saying, okay, what does that mean? They want to get the expected response to what? To command number one. They've got a command set in mind. But this story is just about, let's just get one command to go through. That's it. Sort of like a hello world. You know, if you bring up your development environment, a lot of people will do a hello world because it's a functional thing that proves out a bunch of layers of your tool set. See what I'm saying? So under what conditions? This is a bus that could have a single master or more than one. So they're saying, let's take a simple case, single master on the bus, using the present hardware that they all have access to, the certain hardware sets that they have in the bus, if they're doing an upgrade of an existing project. And they put in a timing constraint. We expect the update to happen in 1 second, or less than a second. So what I'd like to point out here is that this puts pretty tight bounds. It's kind of cut and dried now to either say yes or no. If I'm their product owner, if I'm speaking to the stakeholders, the team says to me, well, we've got this one finished now. If I were to come along and say, well, does this check? Does this check? Does this? It's pretty much a cut and dried. We're not going to get into too much debate about is it done yet or isn't it. And that's the point here. You want to be clear about what you're outlining. So other kinds of stories might be things like, when you're first bringing up the board, can we get flash memory working? That's functional. It's still kind of technical because it's the early iteration. You know, in a system like this, you get your hardware working, you make sure certain bits of functionality are playing, right? So you're doing, in a sense, these vertical slices through the hardware, and that's what Agile teams always look for. But most of the time, you'll hear Agile people say, it's got to be something we can deliver to the customer. Okay? I put a little bit different twist on it when I'm working with embedded systems people because there's so much infrastructure that has to be in place before you can even get dial tone in a typical embedded system. So we keep it functional, but we start with functional slices that maybe don't come all the way through to making a feature the user can appreciate right away. Does that make sense? Okay. Any question on that? By the way, feel free to make a pause for clarifications or something if you'd like to listen to that. Everybody's quiet. Okay. Let's keep going. So what they ended up doing was, in starting this iteration, they picked these five stories to take into this first iteration. And I'll just read a couple. We just looked at this one, read heart value. This one is Rhapsody on hardware. There's a development tool called Rhapsody. They want to get it working on the current hardware. IPC sensor module working from Rhapsody, okay. What else? This is a sample Modbus slave, get that going. And what's this one? continuous integration tool chain working. Okay, so they had these that they chose, and they assigned relative sizes to them. We call it story points of these numbers, mostly 85 for these ones. And all this means is, if you set a bunch of pieces of work on the table in front of you, and they're all very clearly defined, then you just ask yourself, is this one bigger than that one? Yeah, okay, is it twice as big, three times as big? That's all we're doing, just making some relative sizing at first. And then I will show you a little bit about what they do for estimation. In this first iteration, they might not be sure how much time it's going to take to do, what, 8 story points worth of work. Because story points don't really have a meaning at this juncture before you get into your iteration. What we're trying to do is set up a size measure that's independent of how long it takes to do something. Okay. If lines of code was a true measure of how big a software application was, you know, think of how big. Like how big is a house? It might be a contractor that builds houses. One house is bigger than another, right? More valuable than another. We have numbers that help us express that. In software, you know, we try to use lines of code, but it's pretty squirrely. So the Agile community is using another metric. I'll say a little bit more about that in a few minutes. So anyway, they've got 34 story points worth of work. I'm going to show you some things that help the team know that they haven't overcommitted. That's where I'm going with this. Okay, so now that they're going to do this, they estimate the stories, and nobody else gets to do the estimation. This is part of making the world fair. The people who are going to do the work do the estimating. In an Agile team, if you're a manager in some company and you say, hey, staff in the agency, send me in 5 Agilistas, and I've already estimated what they're going to do, and now I just expect to have them work a miracle for me, that's not Agile. That's not the way it works. You have to involve the people who are actually going to do the work in the estimation. They do a two-pass type of estimating. The first pass is simply to do that relative sizing of the pieces of work. The second is to break down those stories into tasks. And I will show you some of an example of that a little further into the slides. But those tasks, those are the things that are just going to be in hours, you know. Those are, you know, things like grading data, quiz tables, things like this. Typical tasks you do throughout your day, developing a system. So for all the estimates, this is really the key thing here, is there's no sunny side estimating allowed. You have to estimate in such a way that your likelihood of being too high or too low is exactly even, to the best of your knowledge as a technical person on the team. And the entire team gets involved in making the estimates that will form the commitment that's going to happen in the iteration. So the team, as a group, will make a promise saying, yes, we believe we can do this much work in this space of time. But they're doing, the foundation of that is this 50% probability level on the estimate. Okay. I think that's really important. All right, so now, how are they going to make sure that they haven't picked too much work? Right? So let's have a look at what they do. They made a list of who's on the team and how many hours they have dedicated to this project over the next 2 weeks. This is real simple math. What percent? Okay, each of these people was 100% except this one who's 50%. That results in these many hours. If you're 100% in 2 weeks, you got 80 hours, right? Real simple math. So we've got like 360 hours. And so we start by using the metaphor of a pail, a bucket, and say, let's have a 20% cushion. Let's not, whatever it is we commit to, let's give ourselves a 20%, you know, margin for other things that just come up. Okay, so we start with that. So we say 288 ideal hours that make up 80% of this. So we're looking for 288 hours worth of work to say we'll promise. Is that clear? And that would make up the commitment for the 2 weeks. So how is that going to work? Let's have a look. All right. So 288 hours is close enough to 300. What happened was, as they took those 5 stories that we saw, they broke out all the tasks underneath those stories, and then they estimated those in hours, and they summed them up. So they first started out by prioritizing the stories. The first one was, I don't have those numbers, but let's say, for example, the first one worked out that it was going to be 25 hours worth of work. They'd say, well, that's not at 300 or 288 yet. Let's do another one. Okay, maybe that's 50 hours. And you break out the tasks and sum them up. Okay, a bucket's not full. Let's go for another. And so on, until they had 5 of them. Now, it didn't total exactly to 288. It was a little bit higher or a little bit lower. The numbers aren't that exact. You don't have to be crazy about it. But it happened that to get those 5 in, it was exactly 300 hours. So they made this little chart on the whiteboard, and they said, here's our 10 days. These are weekends. Here's our 10 days, and we're starting with 300 hours worth of work. It was just coincidence that the 5 of those stories, when you summed up all the hours, came up to exactly 300. I know it seems like a phony example if I just put the 300, but it actually came out that way. So this was on their whiteboard, and they said, okay, so if we're starting with this much work, then theoretically, if the law of averages works in our favor, if we really did estimate at the 50% level and our judgment isn't too far off, then we should be able to burn down the work to zero by the end of the 2 weeks. Make sense? So, to, again, just simple extrapolation. So the notion here is that on average, for any day within here, we would be about on track if we're, you know what I mean, if on this day we've got this much work remaining, if on this day we've got that much work remaining ahead of us. It's that simple. So then they said, okay, so here's what the commitment really amounts to. This team commits to completing 34 story points of work by 5 p.m. on this date. It helps to specify the time of day. And I don't like it to be by 8 a.m. on some morning, because I don't want to tempt people into doing an all-nighter. I have a little sermon that I give teams about not doing tons of extra work in the first iteration. Remind me to tell you what that is in a few minutes, after we get through looking at the pictures. Okay, I want to show you this. This is another thing that's present in the team's room, this blockages list. And what goes on this list is, you see, the idea here is the team isn't making a blanket guarantee, and they're not going to stick their head in the guillotine if all that stuff doesn't come through on that hour, on that day. You know why? Because there are circumstances that are outside their control. And it's not fair to penalize them, okay, if something outside their control gets in the way. Now, there are a lot of things that are going to be outside the team's control that are in somebody's control. And it's the job of the stakeholders and the managers and the executives to make sure that their organization provides the right habitat so that smart people can get real work done. That's the job of management. Okay, now, so we're going to make sure that's happening. How are we going to make sure? By visibility. Anytime something is impeding progress, you know, we saw that simple little chart. We should be able to run the work down just like that if it's that simple. But you know the real world isn't that simple. So we want to get visibility around anything that's getting in the team's way that's not fully within their control to, you know, to address. So this chart here, this has a few things on here. One of the things that happened on the, I think the first or second day, well, it says here, my PC is a bunch of characters. Guys, laptop, the screen went kaplooey, and they ended up having to give them a new laptop. So that took about a day, you know, the dev environment to get transferred over. So that was one of those things that needs support. They needed support from the prototype people. These are the guys building, who built the framework that they're going to work with, the German guys. That was the name of this framework. So they needed some support here. They had a question that they couldn't answer, but they needed help with, so they got that. So things like that go on this list. So what was happening then, as I walked you through this little tour of the team room, I would say the blockage list is so that if there's anything outside the team's control, it gets visibility right away. We note down when it showed up and how quickly it got solved. And the team and the managers come down to the team room every morning, 9 a.m. or so, and have a quick little status meeting, very quick. And believe me, the stakeholders and managers were eager to come and look to see if anything showed up on this list. And they'd sometimes pop over at lunchtime, too, just to make sure something hadn't shown up, you know, later in the morning, because they were eager to make sure the work could progress. There wasn't any like threatening atmosphere going on. Go ahead.
Do you ever feel the need to track blockages by the number of hours that they were actually open?
Yeah, some people do that. Some people will do that. They'll say what time it showed up and what time it cleared, if you want. You know, most of the times I can start people off and not even worry about that. You know, if they show up, let's move them fast. If it looks like things are sitting on here too long, especially if they sit more than a day, and if it starts being a pattern, then I say, all right, let's get more pointed about this and start logging the date and the time. And ask, why is it taking so long, you know? And these will be things that can be discussed when we have this retrospective session at the end of the iteration. If you have a brief meeting at the end of the 2 weeks, is the idea to ask, how did this go? You know, how did this process work for everybody, not just the team, but the stakeholders, you know? And should we keep doing it all exactly the same way, or should we make an adjustment somewhere? And everybody gets a say. Okay, so the point here is that it's not a blanket guarantee that the team is making. Okay, they're making a commitment that says, within the scope that we have control, our judgment is that we can get this amount of work done in that length of time. And by the way, you saw that everything was budgeted for normal work hours, 8-hour days. Okay. So what we did was, remember I said earlier, we had hijacked one of the manager's offices. So we kind of cleared his stuff off of this area on the board, and it happened to be that there's these three panels. So we said, if we turn the story sideways, we could lay out the tasks that go to each story kind of in a row like that. And for the ones that are not started yet, we'll put them in this panel. For the ones that are being worked right now, today, they'll go in here. And for the tasks that are completed, they'll come over to here. And so the idea is there's these little invisible lanes. Go ahead.
I was just wondering, why didn't you do this electronically using some project management software?
You can. It's
pretty much the same thing.
You can, but since everybody was together, yep, and all working in this room, it was simple to set this up. There's no prohibition against doing it with an electronic tool, and there's plenty to pick from.
Nancy and I have had many debates on this.
Yeah.
And her feeling, and I kind of agree that at least in the very beginning, doing it in paper on a wall like this gives it more realism. Mm-hmm. It's easier to feel the process and see the process happening. I'm a big believer. There's a lot of great software out for doing that. But in the beginning, this kind of gives it more of a...
It'll give you comfort to know, of course you know already,
yeah,
that they are using electronic tool. They're using a tool set with this, and IBM has a thing called Team Concert,
yeah,
that is it's intended for agile teams, okay? And they do use that because although they all started together, now the American teams work in America, the German guys want to know what's going on, and they can just see it, you know,
yeah,
online.
Other than just the real estate you're taking up on the board and the wall, in smaller projects it works fine. But let's say that you have some dependencies and you have some cross dependencies that you missed. If you use a tool for that, that may very well show up.
Well, the idea with setting up your iteration is to, within the iteration, you want to not have cross dependencies. Although it's true that in your look ahead, and you do want to be able to look ahead, it's
right,
nice to have all of that there and be able to see how things interlink. I agree with you there. What I like, when people are first seeing the system, I like, if it's at all possible, I like them to use it with the pieces of paper. So this way they're seeing the process, pure and simple,
yeah,
not just how it was thought of in a given tool. Because if you look it through a tool, then you don't have any way to distinguish the tool's opinions from the core simplicity of the process. That's all. So I like to start off this way whenever I possibly can. So let's dig into here a little more and look at how this works.
How many teams were there? How many teams were operating at the same time? And if it was more than one, how did they get coordinated?
There were three groups of people who needed to coordinate. They were intending to be in different places once this project was further underway, but they were all physically here working in this one room for the first iteration, and they coordinated later using Team Concert. Back here?
My question is actually back to the question of the bridge over there. The thing I found most frustrating about trying to use an agile process is that it seemed like, at least implemented where I was working, there isn't a very strong model to capture dependencies and priorities in the sense that if something gets blocked, what can you instantly switch in? And I'm just wondering, is that an immaturity of the team that I work with, or are there practices, or even when you sit down and figure this out, because I kept being told, we'll figure that out later, and I kept thinking, well,
yeah,
you don't know your dependencies.
Well,
yet.
You know, whether or not it's okay to figure those things out later varies very much from project to project. Okay? If you've got too far overboard with this idea of let's analyze it to death and let's, you know, construct a monster size specification and really understand. You know, I've been in companies that do that, and a lot of times what gives rise to that is if a company has a punitive kind of a culture, so that the safest thing to do is to just keep on analyzing and never take action. There are companies where life is best if you just keep on analyzing. And yeah, so it gives rise to that kind of dysfunction. So in some ways, Agile is a big reaction to that. And some people are just so dug into that position, fighting that problem, that they can't see when it actually does make sense to use some of those kind of tools and some of that thinking. Now, I personally have always used that sort of thing. For me, Agile was the way to survive a crazy project that I was on about a dozen years ago, where we really had to just keep making our plan as we went, because it was a very innovative thing, and it hadn't been organized well from the top down. And so that's really where I kind of got my understanding of doing this. All right, let's move along here, and I'm going to continue the virtual tour. Okay, so here's a little bit closer look at the starting board and some of these tasks. I know you can't read these things from where you're sitting, but I do have a closer view of some of the tasks within one of the stories that I'll be coming to. And I had them make a little key. So this was the task. This was the story. In other words, the requirement, if you want to call it that, and the conditions of satisfaction, you know, sort of through my edge and up in that and even fit. Okay, and this is the panel where the task not started. So this is what your board looks like at the beginning of it. And then as you go through the days, you see all these things. It's very visual. You see them moving, you know, over. You see this board emptying out and the other side filling up. So that's what is also really compelling, because it's physical and it's right there. You see it all the time. It's just more visible than if it's online. Okay, here's the one that shows a little close-up of some of the tasks. So within one of the stories, there was this task about checking into the communications interface in Protoff. Again, that was that framework that the German team built. This is function block, control block, programming block. This is an entity that you build within that framework. It's sort of like a big bunch of Lego toys. I'm sure everybody here has dealt with software frameworks, right? And this is about setting up the Rhapsody tool. And so someone estimated 8 hours for this, estimated 4 hours for this, and 6 for this. And the point I want to make here is that it wasn't someone who estimated it, it was the whole team. Now, this is something I don't see getting done often, and I don't even see very many Agile coaches really talking about it, but this helps a team to coalesce. In other words, the temptation is, okay, we break out the tasks, and then whoever's going to do each task, they put down how long it takes them to do it. Poof, done, right? No, don't do it that way. I'm saying, instead, work together. When you're talking about this one, have the team agree. How long should that take? An average person on our team. Now, every team has somebody who could do it in, you know, half an hour, and someone else who's going to take 3 hours to do it, right? Because they're new to that, or they don't do that very often. Every, you know, same way with this one. The whole team, how long should it take to create a function block using this framework? The whole team agreed that an average performer would take about 4 hours, and so on with this one. Now, why bother doing this? Because it seems like more work than everybody just deciding which thing they're going to do and estimate it, right? The reason you bother doing this is you don't want to have to schedule every person's time at the beginning of your iteration. If everybody is claiming what they're going to do, now you've got this complex schedule where everything's allocated to somebody. If I finish my stuff and I'm free, there's nothing for me to work on, maybe, because everything else is taken up by other people. But they're all heads down and buried. So I'm going to feel like, gee, I'm stepping on somebody's toes if I try to take something that someone else has claimed, but, you know, I finished early. So what we want to do is, again, this is about the 50% level estimating. If you just put on these how much it should take an average person, it should all come out in the wash. Sure, if I do this thing I'm not familiar with, it's going to take me longer than 4 hours. By the same token, somebody who's better at this than the average person will finish this one a little bit quicker. It should all balance and come out in the wash. And it gets you out of that hassle of scheduling every little hour of every person's time up front. Okay? So this way, people come in the morning, they look at the board, they look at whatever hasn't been, whatever's a high priority story, the ones up at the top are the higher priorities. You look at the highest priority story that isn't finished yet, and you say, is there something in there that I can do that isn't already in progress? And if there is, you stick your initial on it and move it over to the middle panel, put it in progress panel, and start working on it. Okay? So at the end of each day, the remaining work hours are totaled up. You know, we want to see where we are on that slanted goal line. Okay, so each day, as we started off with the 300 hours worth of work, the next day, I think that says 278, on the next day, the number of unfinished, you know, tasks not started yet, plus the ones that were partially done, they summed up to one number, 278, it looks like that says. And then the next day, 276. That's pretty revealing. In a whole day of five or six people, only 2 hours worth of work got done. That kind of tells you that probably some tasks that were overlooked got discovered and put on the board.
Doesn't that lie? That's the weekend.
Oops. Yeah, this part means the weekend. Sorry about that. Here from Monday to here, there's also a short amount as well. But yeah, you're right, and they were not coming in on the weekends.
You may expect less work to be done when that guy's laptop is broken.
Somebody might have snuck a little something in. But sometimes what will happen is you'll go from one day to the next day, and the line will actually go up. And that might be that people are recognizing that in their estimating, they totally overlooked some tasks. And if that's the case, you have to put them on the board. Because you've always got to work every minute with the best of your knowledge.
How do you estimate partial completion? You've got a story that's estimated at so many hours and you haven't finished it. How do you deal with that?
I think I've got a slide about that that's coming up. But I definitely will cover it.
You mean tasks or stories?
I thought the hours were associated with the tasks, but are they associated with the stories?
They are associated with the tasks.
Oh, with the tasks.
I've got a slide coming up that'll give you that.
Okay.
So hang on, and if I don't go over it, don't let me forget. Okay. So this is about the task not being assigned. The team member puts their initial. When you're ready to start a new task, I think I went over this a little bit already. Look at the highest priority story. Pick whatever it is you've got skills for, put your initials on it. And you could be sharing this task with somebody. A person or a pair can do this. Put your initials on it, move it to the in progress.
At the end of the day,
you're going to estimate how many hours you think are still left to go on this. Okay? So if you started this one, and let's say you worked on it for 4 hours, the estimate was 8, you can ask yourself, are there 4 hours left remaining? You know, because you might, now that you've got your hands in it, you might realize that the estimate of 8 was too high or too low. So what you do is you put what you really believe still remains on there. So in that sense, you're actually changing the initial estimate, so to speak. There's a question over here.
At that point, once you plan your task, is that your task, you own it until it's completed, or can it change to a different person?
It depends on how the team chooses to work together. Most teams don't try to be that proprietary over what they've claimed. They try to help one another. Some teams like to just work in pairs. People work together on each thing. You change the pair you're working with sometimes, you know, the whole pair programming thing. I don't force teams to use it, because I think that only works when you do it willingly. But it's got a lot of stuff in its favor. It's just that, you know, there are some important things in the world that you can't force anybody to do. But so if they do them willingly...
So then the estimate at the end of the day would be, for the average performer, even though you've done most of the work.
Yeah, once it's in somebody's hands... I see where you're getting. Yeah. Let's say you're a performer who was faster than most everybody, and you're going to finish this. Then you can still put what it's really going to take, what it's going to take you to do. If you're in the middle of it and you're going to finish it, yes, you can do it that way.
So the idea is accepting that, you know, what the world looks like is changing from minute to minute. So when you're going to update this, you're going to update this with the best possible knowledge. Mm. So if you know if this whole person's going to be on the fifth person, you know, whatever the reality is, the reality that's important, not trying to fit some estimates.
So if you know you're giving it to someone else, you might pull what you can take.
Well, you talk to them and you work it out. Hmm. So remember, we have that 20% cushion in there. There's going to be a little conferring back and forth now and again. There was a question over here.
So my question was already answered.
Okay, got it. And a couple over here.
Is 8 hours kind of the maximum for a given task, or are there tasks that could go 16, 24, 40?
That's a good question. And here's what I say to people. If you're really struggling to break something out so that it's 8 hours or less, if it feels to you like it's 12 or even 16, okay, go ahead and do it. But here's the price you pay. If you have lots of tasks on there that are bigger than a day, when you look at that overall board, you're not going to see as much motion. It's going to be harder for you to tell where you stand, okay? So once in a while, a few tasks that are kind of big, I don't have too much of a problem with it. But the bigger you make them, the harder it is to tell where you really are at, okay? So it's a trade-off.
Just a quick question on pairs and estimation. If people who are working together on an 8-hour task, it may still take 8 hours. It might be shorter because of combined knowledge.
That's,
but in real engineer time, that's...
That's something the teams can work on when they allocate this and when they estimate.
I was just curious, does it wash out at the end, like in terms of the... Do you have to worry
It's real hard to generalize.
Okay.
Teams get to know how it works for them, and that's one of the reasons why you want to have a discussion at the end of the iteration. You know, the smart thing to do is figure out what's working for you. Don't worry about what the commandments are from the Agile world or from any external authority. When this is practiced well, it's kind of scientific method. Okay, let me pick up the pace a little bit because I got some more things that I really want to get into with you here. Okay, so let's say this task estimate is updated. Here's one that's been through the mill for a while, okay? Somebody whose initial is T picked up this task, set up test using pressure M, that's a module within the framework, to simulate IP values. Okay, they started off estimating that at 16, so here's an example of one that was kind of big. Then it got crossed off one day and left at a 12. People had the rule that they would, at the end of the day, update their estimate, and then somebody would go across and tote that up and put the, you know, the point on the whiteboard for where they're at. Okay, so example day one, if you work 6 hours of the 16, but you feel sure that there's more than 10 hours remaining, the new honest estimate might be something like 12. So I already mentioned this kind of thing. So you're putting that on the card. And that means that in that burndown chart, you would be tending to force the point upward, you know, meaning that you're splitting the time schedule. Now the idea is if you're doing the balanced estimating, it should happen just about as often that something finished faster than expected. That should tend to balance it out. And remember, you've got some of that cushion, too, that you put in the bucket. You put a 20% cushion in there as well. So the team should feel confident that they can get this amount of work done. It shouldn't feel like it's a maybe, just a real line, you're killing yourself to just get that. Okay? That's how it should be on a proper Agile team. When things go wrong, even with the best plans, things sometimes go wrong, even with all these wonderful mechanisms. Let's see, I'm going to show you two examples of things going wrong. This I consider to be poor iteration management, and I consider this to be proactive iteration management. And I wanted to show you and contrast them. In this chart, let's say this is the day and this is the future. We can't see this. And we're seeing that the team is kind of above the line a couple of times. Well, first of all, I'm not worried about that. And sometimes managers get the wrong idea with Agile. They think, oh, I've got to watch this like a hawk. And if the team is 1 millimeter behind, you know, I'm going to come in there and give them the third degree. Or if they're a little bit ahead, oh, that's my signal that I can pile more work on them. You know, so some managers have this old mentality, and you have to fight this, right? But they somehow think that doing Agile right means pinging it exactly on that line every single day. And it doesn't mean any such thing. This is only a guideline to help the team feel confident that they're going to get there. That's it. You could vary all over hell, but if the team, in their engineering judgment, says, yeah, I kind of know why that happened, and I'm confident that they'll be all right. If that's a real honest best judgment, then that's okay. Now, a lot of teams just have this terminal optimism that really does them in, too, so I'm well aware of that. I've done it. But now, let's say that we're getting over to here. Let's say I'm their coach and I can't see these bars further ahead, and we're on this day right here. I'm going to be thinking, that's getting kind of significant. What's going on there? Let's talk about it a little bit. We might talk about it in that brief stand-up meeting. We get to this day, and now I'm sure there's trouble. If I was their product owner, I'd be saying, uh-oh, let's think about replanning. Let's think of, what does this mean? What's going on here? Because now, you see about a third of the bar is above the line. Usually when about a third of it is above the line, you're not going to recover. It's just my hunch from experience. I have seen one team recover from it, but that was kind of a special situation. So once you're getting out here, something's gone wrong. You're probably not going to recover. So the thing is, you could spend this next week, this is 5 days here, you could spend this whole week with the team walking around like with a cloud over the head, we failed, we're not going to make it, let's just schlep along. That's not very healthy. It would be smarter to ask, what's the reality here? What's going on? And given that something has happened that's out of our control, and it was out of our manager's control too, right? Remember the blockage chart? Maybe they can't deal with everything. Okay? Like I had a team that got into this kind of trouble one time where another team offshore was supposed to deliver something partway into consideration. We were supposed to cooperate with them. And it became clear that wasn't going to happen. So, you know, they should have just replanned right there. But they chose not to, but they had their reasons. And, okay, these things happen in coaching. You can't make everybody do what you think they should do. But it was six of one, half dozen of the other. They had a good justification for just replanning. In other words, pausing, looking at the storyboard, and saying, is there something on this board that we should just de-sculpt? Just remove it from the iteration and set a new goal of what our work remaining is. Should we do that and then just, and now try to stick to that one? So in this case, somebody did do this. That's just a smarter thing to go. It's more realistic. Go ahead.
How do you handle things when you have an external commitment? Like you have a customer commitment for something that if you don't deliver by a certain date, you can get sued.
It's the same way. I mean, the same problems come up. If,
yes.
If you can get sued because something didn't happen and it really is out of your control, you're going to get sued. You can negotiate with them. You can talk to them. But this can't disappear realities that happen. All you really get to do is say, how will we respond? Now, what would have happened, and I don't show this in these set of slides, but there should be like risks and issues. Some people use over-planning as a way to cross their fingers and hope a risk disappears. And you can't really do that. You know, a risk element is just either going to happen or not happen. And all you can do is decide how prepared you're going to be for it. Right? Like no amount of preparation in Japan could have prevented the tsunami, right? They could have chosen to be prepared for a 50-foot wave instead of a 20-foot wave, but those are all decisions that somebody makes somewhere in the setup. Okay, and that's kind of how it is for these things where people can get sued. And I have had teams get into situations like that, where they had contractual stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, we worked through it. There's a question?
Nice. What this does do for you, though, is that it shows you, whether you choose to expose it to the customer or not, is your choice, but at least you know that this danger is impending, and you can deal with it however you can.
Right, okay, let's move right along here. So what the team members owe to each other, they'll have a team norms chart making commitments clear to each other. This is something that, you know, I see open source people do something equivalent to this. They kind of have to state the expectations pretty explicitly, don't they? Like, who's going to be allowed to commit? How do you earn the right to lead, you know, this or that sub-team or project or something? You know, all these rules. So they become more explicit, and they're kind of forced to do that because they're distributed, you know? And I like to do it with agile teams. I like to say, well, let's have some work rules, you know? If there's going to be a rule around pairs of people picking up a task, how should the math work, you know, for the scheduling to come out right, things like that. So, you know, they'll pick things like when are they going to do their daily thing, when should they update the task estimates, Some people say we have to do it at lunchtime. Some people say do it before you leave. And then somebody will tote up the burn down thing in the morning. You know, just a little bit of coordination like this. This team had another one on their list. They said they want people ought to have it as a rule to see if we know an answer within our team before we go and ask the others questions, because their other team is really busy. Is there any question? All right, so in this first iteration for this team, as they went through it, I think I've got an animation here, yeah. As they went through, this is what happened to them. So at the end, they had something like 53 hours left of work when they intended to be done at zero at this point. Now, how did that happen? Well, there were a couple of mistakes that contributed to it, but the biggest thing really was that one of the guys got pulled off for like two entire days because of an emergency on another project. And his background was really crucial to a couple of the stories. So a couple of the stories really suffered for him being on this sort of thing. But, you know, you could agonize over that, but the nice thing about it is, and you could use it as an occasion for blaming, but the nice thing is because there was such tight day-to-day control and visibility of everything that it was crystal clear that this slippage was in large part due to that action. And now the pulling him off didn't just happen at random or without thought. They really did have a need on another project that was very important. And so the managers realized from this example that, okay, when you set an Agile team loose on something, there's a high probability that they really can deliver what they think they can. If you are going to interfere with them, you are probably going to sink that delivery. Now, if you choose, it's still your company, you can still choose to get this project a bit in trouble in order to save that one, and it might be the right decision, but it's really a decision at another level, and it can in no way put a shadow on this team. You know what I'm saying? That there's no way that anybody can say this team failed. So one of the guys in Germany, he says, you know, in a funny way, it's actually good that that happened, because a lot of people are curious about what's going on over here in the corner. He says they would have less faith in it if we totally did everything to plan and got out of the way. He actually said that. He said that it would seem like a little too contrived. And so I thought this was kind of funny, kind of an interesting take. And so he says that by the fact that they did get into a little trouble, it actually gave it more credibility with the many onlookers. Because there were a lot of people around in the building who were, you know, kind of wondering, is this going to be another fad of the month? Or what, you know what I mean, is this real? Or what's going on here? You know, the way it's spreading around. Now, you got a question?
Yeah, related to what you said earlier about replanning.
Yeah.
I mean, taking this example, so at the point that they pulled this guy off whose knowledge is integral to certain tasks, should they not have pulled those tasks off the plan? In order to
you could have. It's something that you could have done maybe at this point when you saw this happening, you know, looking at the slide I just gave previously, you might have said, if that's going to be two whole days, then let's. But they didn't know how long it was.
They didn't know how long, so they just pulled him off for something, and then he got wrapped up in it.
You know, they're thinking maybe he can come back in another half an hour. So, it was one of those, you know, water torture kind of things. So let's talk a little bit about Agile Beyond here. In the open source world. I was going to say something more about what all projects I thought were using Agile, but as I looked at descriptions that I saw around, I realized that there are a number of open source projects that seem Agile to me, but they don't claim that they're using it. Go ahead.
One last question on the previous segment. At one point, you talked about de-scoping and so on, and somebody said, you know, keeping it, not visible to the customer and so on. And at least as far as my knowledge of Agile, it is visible to the customer. The customer is involved, so they couldn't really de-scope it and add it to a project and not have the customer know it.
Well, that's true. But you know, sometimes projects are being delivered to an internal customer as well, and they might make up a component of some bigger thing that's going outside. So I teach a practice where we have layers of customers, and we do some strategic decisions as we lay out our release plans, which releases, an embedded system a lot of time needs to begin with some internal releases, and then they start doing external releases. And at each stage of the game, you're playing to a different audience, so to speak. So, you know, by and large, you're right. A lot of Agile teams, especially if they're just doing business apps or something, you know, where they're in close contact with who they're selling to, you're right. The visibility is right there. And the nice thing about it, though, is trouble shows up very early as it's brewing. The nice thing for, you know, a lot of times I work with project managers who've spent a big part of your career just learning how to be spin doctors, right? How to turn bad news into a sunny scenario. And getting them to drop that is really difficult. And the nice thing about watching stuff with a burndown chart is it takes them off the hot seat of having to try and decide, how long do I try to hide this before I'm going to have to admit something? Do you know what I'm saying? This decision of how much to cover up and for how long, you know, to, you know, sort of like a gambler. How long do you think you can win it back before you're going to have to admit that you lost? It kind of takes project managers off the hot seat for that stuff. But it does demand that the people above them understand this and buy in to the openness. Because if they don't, then you're playing a dangerous game. You see what I mean? So that's why you need the exec levels to have some sort of understanding of this. So there's been some ugly stories around, you know, situations where there wasn't that kind of cover. All right, I know a little something about the Ubuntu people because I know someone who coached them in lean stuff. So anybody read up much about lean thinking in connection with Agile? Yeah, you familiar with Tom and Mary Coppinger? All right, well, they do lean software development coaching. It's a very close cousin to Agile. And the Ubuntu Linux people got some training from them. And I was very impressed by the level of commitment and level of knowledge. The Ubuntu folks, you probably know, they come together, all of them, all over the world, they get together periodically. And so they did this kind of training. And I know that they're still making use of it. They don't do a lot of the kinds of Agile practices that they suppose that you're in the room together, obviously. But I'll talk a little bit more about the key elements of Agile, though, whether somebody says they're Agile or not. See, to me, the important stuff is a little bit below the surface for what practices you're actually doing. I'll give you an example. This team whose room we just toured, I said that they do the stand-up meeting every day. Right. Well, my first Agile team, we didn't know about that because Agile hadn't been invented. But what we did was got together as a group 2 times a week to talk about our code and about the architecture. We did this for 1/2 hour twice a week. We didn't have a need for a daily stand-up, but we were keeping in touch with how well we were doing. And to me, that's the key thing. If you're in constant touch with how well you're progressing, that's what matters. Now, it does matter that you communicate with one another, but we were doing that, too, you see. So here's another one that I saw some interesting stuff about, visualization toolkit. And these folks, I put a little footnote in here because the slides will be available for you to grab a hold of. Other people before me have, you know, taken things like the Agile Manifesto and compared them to elements of open source. These guys had a nice write-up. I was looking at Eclipse, and I noticed that they seem to me like a group that would claim to be Agile. I don't see in their literature that they claim to be Agile, but I thought it was interesting that, to my view, it looked like they had all the elements. You see what I'm saying? Well, maybe people are shy about making these claims because there's so much that has come from the Agile community along the lines of, you know, unless you're doing this or that practice, you're not agile. You know, there are a lot of people who think that if you aren't doing pair programming, then you can't possibly be an agile team. And I see it as just one of many practices that are good, you know, if you know how to use them and you want to use them and you do it willingly, but you're free to come up with a better idea or a different idea. So what interested me about, you know, thinking on this is that it leads to all these questions of form versus substance. And that kind of gets into, you know, this problem that I mentioned when I started off about people having bad experiences on so-called agile teams. Before I got into agile, you know, like I said, I've been 15 years working in various kinds of embedded systems. And during that time, there were four different companies that I had worked at that put themselves through a transformation, so they called it. Like, remember in the 80s, the total quality thing was all around? I remember shortly after that, there was another thing came around, and it, I can't remember even the name of it. I think one of these transformations was called Lean, and it made me think that, you know, maybe that's just a bunch of baloney. But see, I didn't understand. See, I was at the working level in these companies. And each time that this kind of excitement came around, I'd see all the sloganeering, I'd see the posters, I'd see the quotes from Deming, and I'd say, wow, this sounds like really good stuff. When are we going to start doing this? And then, you know, there would just be these meetings that the managers went to, and then no more about it after a while, you know? I'd be wondering, well, what the heck happened? You know, two of those companies went out of business. They were trying to do this turnaround as sort of a last-ditch thing. But it seemed like there wasn't any hooks for working level people to get in on any of this stuff. But with Agile, there actually are. I'm going to say a little something about that in a few more slides. But so a little bit about the one thing I wanted to say about the Ubuntu people is I thought it was interesting that, you know, we emphasize communication in Agile. And I asked Tom and Mary, I said, well, how do they communicate? How do they get the level of communication? She says, well, they actually don't want people to talk together by phone. Because if two or three developers talk something out in a phone conference, the rest of the community didn't hear it. So they have a rule that everything's going to get transmitted in email because that's the way they include everybody. So what communication means can and should vary by the context, I think. So it's just a little example to kind of get you thinking. So they have very different constraints. So I was just talking about this one, the distributed thing, and how to communicate well. If you're distributed, well, maybe you make a rule that says we don't have subgroups making decisions in person or in a phone conversation, even though it's quicker. There's a price to pay in the wider community, you know, like causing divisions. Stakeholders are a lot less clearly defined. Voice of customer doesn't really get enforced by the business structure. You know, in the different set of constraints that open source is working with. But I think this is still the key point, and I think the essence is really there. This is what the companies do. They talk about flowing value at the pull of the customer. You know, that means you're looking for what the customer wants and you're responding to it. You're not stacking up tons of inventory on speculation. You know what they're going to buy, and then pushing it at them, and having to discount it like crazy because you can't move the inventory. If you can instead be able to respond so quickly that you can wait until people decide what they want and then poof, supply it very quickly, that's the idea. I like using the example of the book publishing. You know, not so long ago, if you were going to publish a book, you had to, you couldn't do a print run unless it was going to be a couple thousand copies, right? So you wouldn't try to get a book printed unless you thought you could sell a couple thousand of them, you see? So, but once you did that, now you had the inventory, you had to somehow push that out through distribution channels, okay? So a lot of business logistics were about doing that. If instead you change to currently, they have machines now that can print one book and do it economically. Some bookstores actually have these things. So you can now wait and, you know, as an author, you can put the text together, and if one person wants to buy your book, they can have it. So there's an example of being able to respond quickly. It's all about this flow business. And I think that's really what ties Agile together with what people are doing in open source, the essence of that. figuring out who is the customer. A lot of times there's quite a bit of debate about that. Open source community, right? It starts out being yourself, you know, the whole phrase about scratch your own itch. Because you got to have that motivation. But, you know, the newer things like Firefox or something, they've thought long and hard about who the customers are and come up with techniques to figure out what they want and to respond to it. Who is flowing the value? Well, we've got the developer community, right? And then we've got the adopters, who is a community that wants business people to create plugins and so on. So I think this is really the key about the essence. Let's move along here. Governance. Okay. I was intrigued by this idea here of people-driven versus rule of law. And I think there's some real substance to that. In Agile, we have a team of decision-making practices. And of course, they have an open source as well. But David pointed out to me an article that's in Wired Magazine. And the title of it, I'm just curious if anybody has read this. It's in the February 28th issue. The title is called Why People-Powered Projects Are Ruled by Tyrants. Anybody read this? Anybody seen it? But let me read you just a little paragraph from it so you get the gist of it. Because I think it's a real thing, and maybe they have a blow up for the article, but let me read you what it says here. It says, the volunteer model makes them almost futile in structure. He's talking about open source projects. Mm. Makes them almost futile in structure. An enormous mass of unpaid serfs kept in line by a small group of paid manager nobles, in turn serving at the pleasure of the kingly founder, whose authority is more or less absolute. After all, when you create a dominant website, but eschew the vast wealth that could come with it, conventional checks on your power no longer apply. You have no shareholders or paying customers to mollify. Right? Competitors don't bother challenging you, since how can they be a market leader when that leader is unbound by market forces? Worthwhile question, isn't it?
That particular paragraph is about WikiLeaks, by the way.
Yeah, you're talking about Julian, the founder of WikiLeaks, and also talking about other prominent founders as well, open source. But yeah, so I'm thinking, yeah, people-driven. You kind of need it people-driven to get the motivation and the sense of caring about something, but yeah, it can run amok. And so I'm tempted to say a little something about what Agile teams do so that they're not that way. You saw the discussion about doing the estimating and moving it all together about how long should it take an average performer on this team to do something. That gets the team having a discussion, and that's going to bring out various people's opinion about what's involved. When you do that, the more experienced people talk about what they know. And the newer people on the team learn from that, just from hearing that discussion. A lot of knowledge gets transferred. In the same way, there's a similar discussion that goes on when people are doing these story point estimates, too. But, you know, they'll be asking, well, why should this story be considered three times as big as this other one? In order to have those discussions, you've got to have some concept of what architecture you're thinking of. Because a certain thing could be easy to do in one architecture and a lot more work in another. Or it might be that people are making different assumptions. Well, this was easy to develop, but it's a lot of work to test it. Oh, yeah, I wasn't thinking so much about testing because I'm not a tester. You know, those discussions start going around the team, and they very efficiently bring out exactly the right information that everybody needs to know. And that's the miracle of story estimating when you use this planning poker game type thing that we use. It helps bring out exactly what you need to know. And in a way, that's information flowing at the pull of those who need it, meaning that information comes out from the group to the group, and sometimes from the product owner to the group. It comes out in response to the group's need for it. By contrast, a big specification document is an information push system. Mm-hmm. Somebody or somebody's sat down and tried to do a mind dump of everything they thought the developers were going to need to know, right? And they put it in a big document. And now the developers and testers and everybody else have this horrible chore of trying to fish out what they really need to know from this document. example of an information push system. So in Agile, what we're really trying to do, even with the practices within it, is we're trying to implement this pull system idea. So bring the information that's needed just in time. Don't inventory it. And at the same time, you want to balance that, though, like the questioner back here said. You know, sometimes you really do have to try and think ahead about the other dependencies and contingencies. And yeah, I don't deny that. It's a balance, really. So see, that's really what I'm trying to get at there. So I think those things tend to help us in Agile not fall into some of these traps where it can be too autocratic, maybe. Right? And I recognize the need for control. Like, you know, in open source, there's lots of people who want to run away with your with your product, stick their label on it, or do other kinds of encroachments. So there's sort of a temptation maybe to over-control and to, you know, circle the wagons maybe too much. But anyhow, inside of Agile, and I was going to say also, that notion of the task estimates being what the average performer in the team can do, I've had managers ask me about that. In fact, I had one of them say to me, that's why he had confidence in letting the team have complete say over the estimates. Because, you know, his question to me was, before I explained that to him, he was wanting to know, well, couldn't the whole team just decide to sandbag all the estimates to give themselves an easy time? Now, this question I don't think could come from a manager who had actually been a software developer. This guy's background was as a physicist. Because if you've ever been in software development, you can't get a whole team degree on anything. You know? Forget about this fear that they're all going to agree to sandbag their estimates and all do it in the same way. It's just not going to happen. Can't get people to agree on the time of day. Now here's my so what part. Let's say, okay, so how can you, you know, take away some of what we've talked about here and actually put it to use in your favor? I was thinking about that, and I thought, well, suppose you land in a company that claims they're doing Agile. And maybe you land in one of these hell holes where, you know, your head's in the guillotine, you know, if you make a commitment as a team, you know, if you're working for these managers who thinks that the organization has no commitment to the team, but the team has plenty, you know, to everybody else. Or if you're working in one of these places where, okay, well, let's just hurry up. Let's just work really fast, and it's Agile. We're just going to be extra flexible and work really fast. I've actually had people tell me that's their Agile definition. If you find yourself in one of these places, think about this core idea that you need this balance of technical judgment and business judgment. And you might even talk to people about the Agile practices that help reinforce that. We've gone over some of them. If it really is an Agile company, they've got to have genuine safeguards against this kill the messenger syndrome. I mean, how many companies claiming to be Agile actually do protect people who give honest estimates? And how many actually talk about estimating at the 50% level? Not too many, I don't think. So you can always bring it up. You can say that's about facing up to reality. And the whole thing about having a burn-down chart is about facing up to reality. That's part of the essence inside of Agile. Okay, so this kill the messenger thing is so common that it's a cliche, but it still happens. So some of these safeguards, whole team estimating prior to commitment. A lot of preliminary estimating will happen. You know, but at the point where you're ready to kick off an iteration and say, yes, we'll definitely get so much work done in this span of weeks, at that point, everybody who's going to have their hands in the work should be involved in that commitment. If they're not, something's wrong. Okay? So if you're in a company that's not doing that, you can fish around, you can email me, and I'll help you gather evidence to make your case. Impediment removal. It's not a one-way street. The managers should be involved in removing impediments. The image that comes to mind for me is, you've ever seen the Canadian ice sport with the stones?
Curling.
And they slide in there. And they have those guys out front that are sweeping like mad for the stone to go better. I think it is the manager's job, right? I part of the job anyway. And I said this to a team a group I was talking to in Norway, and they all smiled, and I thought, oh, good, that was a hit. And then one of them said, a couple months later, he says, have you ever seen the Norwegian curling team on TV? And I said, no, I haven't. He says, well, you know, the guys who do the broom thing, the Norwegian team, they're always dressed in clown suits. So I didn't know it, but I was telling them. The clowns. and the other big thing that you'll see lots written about in Agile community is this whole idea of sustainable pace. Oh, that reminds me, I was going to say why in the first iteration I don't want the team to like work extra long hours. You saw how they estimate it, right? They figure out how many person hours they've got in assuming 8-hour days, right? So some people think, well, this is our first iteration, we really want to prove that we're great, so we're going to just nail it super, we'll just work 12 hours every day, you know, we'll just really knock ourselves out. And I tell them, don't do that, because what you're doing in that first iteration is you're laying down your initial reading on your velocity. Remember I said these story point numbers, they're meaningless numbers when you start out, right, but just a relative ranking of one thing to another. But we're going to use them to reveal what the team's productivity is. And by doing that, we'll say, well, first of all, they did traditional estimating. They broke out and add up, broke out the tests and added them up to know that those 34 points of stories could fit into the 2 weeks, right? You saw by the explanation how they fit that in. If they get that done in the 2 weeks, that's great. If things go better than expected and they get it done sooner, then maybe they could pick another story in off their backlog and get that done, you know, if that were to happen. And that would mean that their velocity, instead of being 34, is maybe 34 plus 5, if that's what the other story was worth. So, but it doesn't help you to distort your reading, you see. If you work 12-hour days and then finish 50 points worth of stuff, you know, management's going to say, oh, here's a team that can do 50 points worth of work in every 2 weeks. So now we'll budget the rest of the project that way. So I say to the team, work at a pace that you are willing to sustain, that you would like to sustain forever. You know, if you do that right out of the gate, you're just going to have a calmer ride. You know what I mean? Your information is going to stabilize quicker. You know, you won't be ping-ponging all over the place. You know, because people who do this killer first iteration, then they're all burned out for the second one. Right? They want a break. And so their numbers, you know, start going like this. You don't have to bother with that. Just thought I'd mention it. And here's the thing that I like to use this to help people understand how this whole system is supposed to work. These two yellow arrows represent relationships that are really fundamental in Agile. They're so fundamental that we want to make sure they're really working at all times. We want to make sure that the team can stay in control of the code, maybe the code in the hardware if it's an embedded team. We want to make sure that I should change that word to stakeholders, because the stakeholders includes customers, but it also kind of includes your internal company stakeholders as well. That group is communicating with the team in such a way that the correct thing is going to get built. Right? And so we put closed-loop control around both of these activities. And what do I mean by closed-loop control? Well, we want to make sure that the team is staying in control of the code base. What does that mean? Well, there shouldn't be any mysterious crashes that no one can explain. There shouldn't be, it shouldn't be impossible to recreate the build that just got shipped, right, if you want to. This is all part of staying in control of the code base. There shouldn't be, if I check in my module, it breaks the build and we can't figure out how to get the build going again, then there shouldn't be this kind of craziness. That's all staying in control of code base. So, you know, Agile teams these days, there's lots of information out there in the world on continuous integration and refactoring and all these techniques to help you stay in control of this. So that moment to moment, the code is buildable, whatever unit tests you have are not broken. If they are broken, then it's the team's job to make it the highest priority, get in there and fix the broken tests. Or a lot of times team will say, oh yeah, I know those three tests are failing. That's okay, they're not that important. You should have taken them out. Well, don't let them fail then. Go in there and take them out. You know what I mean? You got to keep it clean. You got to keep the machine running. So that's what I'm saying about this control loop, because that's part of staying in balance. On this side, you want your stakeholders, and it could be a product owner who's representing them. I don't think it's an absolute that every Agile team has to have that role. Sometimes teams can talk directly with their stakeholders. I've seen teams do that. But the point is that once you're in an iteration, you're ticking off that work. You're not piling it all up till the last day and then getting it signed off. You get it signed off as you go. And so they're making sure that the correct things are getting produced, that each of those stories coming out is doing what's expected. And also they talk to the team at the end of the iteration, demo what's been built, talk about what could be built, what's now possible, and so on. So that's part of that control loop. So if you do both of these, the whole thing really can work. But it depends on the being willing to face the reality. Honest estimates, where are we really at? Do we have to cut scope? Do we have to change path? Sometimes you just have to change path because everybody's best knowledge didn't line up with reality. And I think that's my last slide. Nope, I got a small disclaimer that I stuck on here at the end. I just wanted to highlight a couple of things that weren't seen on this virtual tour, but that are important. I just wanted to make a statement that I don't want anybody going away from tonight thinking, oh, that's all there is to know about Agile. There's this whole team decision-making method that I didn't really get into at all. It's really important that a team be able to make decisions that they're willing to carry out without a lot of dissension and backbiting on the team. There are some techniques to do that, but that are honest negotiation. It's not touchy-feely, split the difference, crap. It's real principled negotiation, okay? Risks and issues board. You should also have in your team room something, risks, issues that could come up, but that haven't come up yet. Just things that you're watching. The upfront activities to generate user stories and all the high-level architecture stuff. I did say a little bit about it before I got into here. But I just want to make the point that I think it's unfortunate that some agilists say that you don't need to do any upfront planning. I think that's sort of a... Sometimes people say things just to be provocative, just to kind of get noticed. And I don't know, maybe there are some people who really believe that, but I don't know any coaches who don't do some upfront work with their teams before getting into the first iteration. And the team retrospecting and Kaizen type stuff. We didn't really talk about that because we were just kind of on a tour through the team room, probably through the iteration, kind of like what I was doing. And that's it. Oh yeah, that's true. Any further questions people want to raise? Go ahead, David first.
Yeah. Actually, it was interesting you talked about team decision making method because it was about to ask kind of a question of suspecting that it might be important to the team to make the decision by consensus. Or the question is, what if every member of the team is willing to commit except one member who's absolutely not?
Okay, here's how I'll answer that. You've all got pens and paper. There's a thing you can Google. There's an article called Decide How to Decide. It's by Ellen Gottsteiner, and it came out a bunch of years ago in, I think, Software Development Magazine. But you can find it. You can Google it. You'll get the whole text. It's a good article on that. I use it with teams that call it. Okay? So it's called Decide How to Decide. You can find it. And but it's too long a topic for me to get into in the Q&A session. Okay? But, so I just have to leave it at that. Okay, Meg, do you have a question down here?
It seems like when you were talking about assessing the time on the basis of the average person in the team, that seems to imply that your team is familiar with all aspects of what you're working on, which of course in the ideal world is the best way to go. But in my experience, what you get is, and especially because even now Agile is still considered somewhat new, and quite often find yourself in Agile planning extremely difficult?
Well, here's how I handle that. Virtually every team I coach has got too much specialization going on, more than is healthy, let me put it that way. People are too siloed. I recognize the need for some amount of specialization, and I think the actual community has to come up and face that very much, okay? But let's talk about situations where your product has some parts in C, some in C++, or whatever. But so some of your team could do this task, and a bunch of your team couldn't even think about doing that task. In that case, of those who could do that task, among them, what should it require? It just means that when that one's up on the board, there's a bunch of people who aren't even candidates for picking it off to do it. Okay. Now, I've had teams where the work was so bifurcated that it made sense to have two different subteams. Right? I had a team once that was doing a banking, I don't even want to call it an application because it was more like reconfiguring off-the-shelf stuff. And within that team, there were two people who were really operations people. And they were on the team because they needed to figure out how operations were going to change as we were doing this stuff and to adjust it if we were going along incrementally. And so the ops work really couldn't be done by anybody else on the team, and all the rest of the team work couldn't be done by the two ops people. So it made sense to say, all right, we are one team in the sense that these two things are very linked, but let's have two different labor buckets and two storyboards. You know, here's the batch of things for the two operation people, and here's the batch of stories and tasks for the, you know, after the labor people. See what I mean? So you could do something like that.
But part of what we talked about in when I was over in Germany and in my own company too, is you try to find little ways of doing mini cross training. So yes, you've got, you know, the operations team that does this and the other person that does that. But even just when you have your stand up and everybody's in that stand up, whichever bucket they're in, just hearing what the other person's working on, you can start picking up little pieces of knowledge. So it becomes less clearly defined that one person can't do anything at all. You know, there's another thing called pair programming, which is a practice that 2% of the planet likes, and I'm in that 2%. but that's one of the things that comes out of it. There was one company that the previous company that I worked at did pair programming, and I was like super productive after like a month and a half on this super complex application because I'm working alongside somebody else who could fill in the gaps as I was going along. So there was nothing holding me back from getting knowledge on the system. But that's kind of overboard. Most places don't like that. But you try to find opportunities for, even if it's just overhearing people talk about what they're working on in their stand-up thing, you can start getting a sense of what's going on.
Yeah, a little bit of cross-training goes a very long way. You know, you don't have to get the equivalent of a minor in somebody else's thing. You can just be barely passable. And, you know, if they're absent someday and you can just schlep that bit of work along a teeny bit, they can make a difference between getting everything done. Yes?
Yeah, you know, I live in a, I work in a cube farm. And do you find that inhibits agile?
Yeah, it tends to inhibit it. What I did, my
because Because we are, quote unquote, using the agile process, but still, if you go getting up and chatting, it doesn't seem out.
Thanks for coming, guys. My first Agile team was in a cube farm, and what we did was we managed to be delivering enough that some people wanted to be nice to us, and so we asked, actually there was a point where a department was moving, and we said, could we get a lab where the lab is in the same spot as our cubes? In other words, we wanted a center area with an integration machine and some nice hardware, and our cubes just fanning out off of it, and that was a nice arrangement.
The other thing to do is take the cube walls down that way as well.
Especially if you can do it at midnight and take them to some dumpster 20 miles away. But yeah, there's various things. But there are some companies that actually really put together some nice agile work areas now because they see how worthwhile it is.
Yeah. I've seen more than one article claim that even in a cube farm in the same office, you almost have to treat it like a distributed team. because there's still obstacles to free communication.
Yeah, when you have people who are, they're on a different floor, I mean, there's a lot less interchange happens casually.
Happens.
It's the frequency of that that really tends to propel a lot of things along.
Even worse than that, what happens when they take the team that had the cubicles and says, okay, now you have to work at home because we're going to close the office. All you need is your computer and your phone and your high-speed internet.
I think that's unfortunate. I mean, it's nice to have some flexibility, but, people who are working this way by choice, and I'll tell you, I've done it myself sometimes when I'm collaborating with another coach, lives in another city. Sure, we could spend all day on Skype or on the phone, because you know what, and pay for an airplane ticket out of our own pocket and go just be together, because we're going to get four times as much stuff done by just being together. So instead of one day being tedious on the phone and Skype, we can just get together and get a week's worth of stuff done. So, when people do it under their own steam, it's got to pay back.
I'm curious about sort of the trade-off between the big design up front and sort of the Agile's kind of the reaction. How long does it take a particular project to get from big design up front into the actual programming thing, kind of following questions? What kind of artifacts do you use before you get into it? For example, you said you use storyline. For example, a typical web project, say, like screening house, do a database before at the end. What kind of artifacts get set up before you might propose it?
That's a good question. It's quite situational. I hate having to answer by saying it depends. But, I've gone in and had people in the middle of the project where nobody had faith anymore and promised, even though they were 2 or 3 months into a waterfall project where nothing was running yet, but they had coded up a lot of stuff, and I'd show them, look, let's turn this around. Let's free up this inventory, take what you've coded, and let's spend an iteration or two just getting it tested and working and integrated, and then let's start pipelining everything through the way it should go. And once they see that, the next time they start up a project, they've got their own idea what they need prior to the first iteration. They just need to be clear about some of the stories. Write some of your stories are going to start off as big items that have a clear condition of satisfaction. But if you think hard about it, you'll realize that's not a story, that's not something I can do in a few days, that's something that will take weeks by itself. So you're going to need to break it down for it. But nothing says you can't define it crisply. Good requirements work is what's needed. But that kind of got lost in the over-bureaucratization of all this waterfall stuff. So I used to do just requirements for like 2 or 3 years when I was at GE. we're adjudicating this monster spec with like 4,000 pages, so in hell. But good requirements work is what's needed. And it gives you enough of the mechanisms. If you use that together with a little bit of use case and UML type charts, you can do enough of the thinking out of the architecture. You shouldn't try to nail it to every detail, just the broad outline of it. And you can even use iterations to get into fleshing out the architecture, which is a good way to do it. Yeah, absolutely. In fact, that's something I preach, especially for embedded teams. Because you do need a fair amount of architecture thought to have been done before you start cranking on your work.
Right.
However, a good way to evolve that is to give yourself a phase that's going to be dedicated to that. Just today, I mean, it was asking me, how are we going to plan this? And how we've got 60 people on 3 continents, and we're going to do this, new underwriting application. And I said, you're going to need some sort of a core team to get these things thoughts rolling. You're not going to just start in a flash with all 60 people cranking.
Right.
Evolve it, right? Get the core team so they really understand how to do this, and they will become the coaches of everybody else as it grows.
Okay, so last question, which is, so just a typical middle-sized web-based project, would you create the screen layouts and the database?
how critical it is to the customer that screens have a certain layout or certain information at certain points in time. I would be asking how much of the detail has to be frozen at the start.
So
that's what I would be trying to figure out.
Vague definition of the screen.
Yeah, can I connect a little bit?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I've done a lot of web development. And one of the ways of handling that is to start at what they call wireframes, which is basically, you're not even talking about what the page is going to look like. You're talking about this page is for this. From this page,
right,
you can go to this. So you talk about blocks of functionality, nothing about look and feel at all. And to sort of build that into like your last question, the tools can help with that too. So for instance, you know, the big design up front, a lot of people have put together these Word documents. Now something like a Word document, even if only psychologically, is kind of a right one to use many things. You don't think about like going in and modifying it because it's not really designed for collaboration. If you use something like a wiki, it's okay to put a wiki page with the feedback that you know that that thing has. And then later on, as you learn more, you expand it. We have wiki pages that, you know, I started when I joined the company, but I mean now, you know, somebody new starts, they find out something else, they get it, and they just build up over time. It kind of, it lends itself to being expanded and improved over time.
Doesn't the screen,
But going back to the, yeah, going back to the screen layout, you normally start with something like a wireframe. And then from there, you could say what kind of data needs to be on that screen. But even that can all be driven by requirements. So for instance, you'll have a requirement, in a web-based application, you have to start with where the user starts. So you start with stories like, the user should be able to authenticate into the system. It doesn't say you need a login screen that looks like this. It says the user needs to be able to authenticate into the system. And then, you know, fill the details from here. Because you may have like single sign-on functionalities, there's other kinds of solutions.
Okay, well, I'd like to, just so I don't forget, as I wrap up, I'll just reiterate, I got those flyers about the Agile Games thing. There's two other things I should mention. I also got a leaflet about my coaching services, and right now I'm kind of all filled up for clients. But what I do is I offer a free consultation, which isn't a sales pitch. I come in and help you start on solving a problem or a question you have. If you're already doing Agile and things aren't working so right, it might be all you need. And I won't feel offended if I come in and talk to you and you don't buy anything. Because if I can, with an hour's worth of time, if I can unstick you from some problem, that's fine. I'm happy to do that. And the other thing I'd like to mention is that myself and two other collaborators are putting on an all-day training course on May 12th, which is a Thursday. It's going to be here in the Boston area in Burlington. And it's called Lean Agile for FDA. No, what's it called? Safety Critical Software in the FDA, the Lean Agile Way. That's the title of it. And you can find out it's being sponsored by Medical Development Group, medevgroup.org, as a page for sign-ups and all. So it's got the full description there. So if you know people who are doing medical device work, anything where they have to comply with FDA regulations, the other people I'm defending this with, one is project manager who understands Agile, the other is a safety expert who understands everything backwards and forwards about all the FDA regs and how they tie in with Agile practices. So, you know, it's better to talk to the partners. All right, luck for that. I know we're pretty much at the finish time here. And
I just want to hand count to those who are going to Asgard after the meeting. Okay, so we've got Jeff, you, that's two. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So I got 7.
So again, I'm shy.
What? Yep.
I'm shy. Again, very generous. And all day, complete event, 3 days.
Thank you very much.
Nothing.
You're welcome.
You need to sign up, but you need to go.
Thank you.
For the iPod, iPad,